Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Thank you all for being here on a snowy morning. This is the concluding Sunday of our environment and ecology session, so thanks for being here. It is our great pleasure to have with us this morning Judy Geer. Judy is a 37-year educator at ECC with a spate of awards to her name. She's a resident of Holland, New York, and she has particular knowledge about the Adirondacks, New York State's treasure and one of the most protected wild areas in the United States of America. So please greet her warmly. Judy, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Doug, very much. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. It's my pleasure to talk about the Adirondacks, and certainly my pleasure to be here. I was telling Laurel and Doug, my husband and I came here many years ago for a special service, but we have never been in this part of your facility, and it's just lovely. And we have a library in our church as well, so I went around checking out the books, and I was a librarian for a long time, so I find this very interesting. So this is very, very nice on many different levels. I do love to talk about the Adirondacks. It's a special place for Charlie and me. We had many hikes there and climbed a few little mountains in our time, and it's just an extraordinary area. And to imagine it's right here in our own New York State is something that people forget far too many times. So this is a talk about the history and the literature which has come out of the Adirondack State Park. Many, many people have written books, fiction and nonfiction, people who lived in the park, and for many, many reasons, and we'll go over some of that today. So this is a little bit about the background of our Adirondacks. It depends on what sort of day October 2nd, 1536 was. It may have been one of those high autumn days so common in the Northland, with infinite blue sky above, with clear air that brings distant horizons near. If so, the first white man ever to see the Adirondack Mountains of northern New York was the French explorer Jacques Cartier. On that day, in the full flaming of autumn, he came to the Indian village that was to be the site of Montreal. The natives led him up the high hills behind the mud flats. He saw the river below and the level woods that stretched away unbroken to the south. On the horizon, 70 miles off, were mountains. Not one solid range, but a broad sea of hills, intensely blue under the October sun. Cartier may have asked questions about them, for at some time he learned that to the south was an unexplored region of lakes, of mountains, and delightful plains. It would be almost another century before Europeans began exploring this region of lakes, of mountains, and delightful plains that Cartier saw from afar in 1536. In 1609, another French explorer, Samuel de Champlain, and his men sailed south from Canada and into the beautiful lake, which so intrigued him that he named it after himself. 400 years later, we New Yorkers proudly know this area as part of the Adirondack State Park, a spot that from the late 1800s has been designated as forever wild, or about as forever wild as modern humans can manage. One wonders what Messrs. Cartier and Champlain would think if they returned today to peruse their magnificent discovery. If they did return to it, they would find 6 million acres dotted here and there with towns, farms, resorts, and tourists, lots of tourists, of a largely protected expanse of the lakes, mountains, and delightful plains they first encountered there. They would find it to be the largest park in the United States, a spot which takes up fully 1/5 of New York State, making it the size of the state of New Hampshire. A spot which, from the 1500s to the late 1800s, was nearly destroyed by corporate giants anxious to haul away the trees, mineral wealth, and fur-bearing animals to enrich themselves. Nonetheless, it is a spot which, left to nature's own mysterious devices, made a remarkable recovery and presently affords all who visit or read of it a breathtaking picture of the unspoiled world of nature. Most of us who grew up in New York State know something about the Adirondack State Park. To some of us, it conjures up thoughts of a wonderful place to go hiking, camping, canoeing, or mountain climbing. To others, it brings to mind some distant spot north of Albany where mountains, trees, and wild animals exist in a vast, dark wilderness and where winter lasts all year. Actually, the Adirondack State Park is most of those things, although winter doesn't really last all year there. We could wonder about here, however, but not there. The park is also a unique and controversial combination of recreational public lands mixed with private enclaves, historical sites of great importance, and a natural beauty par excellence, which has elicited the fascination of thousands of people throughout the centuries that this area has been known by humans. William Chapman White, one of the Adirondack's most passionate biographers, if a place can have a biographer, has said, "Nowhere else in America but in this Adirondack country are so many varied features crammed into such a small space. With such a variety of jagged cliff, rolling hill, lonesome pond, upland meadow, placid farmland stream, roaring mountain brook, fog-wrapped peak, and quiet lake, and all within a few miles of one another. That exotic mix of terrain is right here in our own New York State. And, most wondrous of all, in the late 1800s, our state went to a legal extreme to protect this exceptional piece of real estate from destruction. The story of how and why this happened is something every American should know and take pride in. It's a story of nature at its best and of human beings at their best also. First, how did this area become such a dramatic hodgepodge of high mountains, countless lakes and ponds, tiny streams, and wide rivers, including the source of the mighty Hudson River? And lush rolling hills, all stuffed within a smallish area. For that answer, we have to go back over a billion years before the first slimy sign of life crawled out of the ocean's muck. This makes the Adirondack Mountains the oldest mountains in the United States and some of the oldest in the world. When they first rose up from the Earth's crust, these mountains were also some of the tallest in the world. But in the eons of their existence, wind and weather have eroded them into their current form, the tallest of them barely a mile high. And the tallest one is?
Mount Marcy.
Mount Marcy. Oh, you're good. Very few people truly know that when I give this talk. Although they were mostly covered with glaciers, during the various ice ages, it is speculated that glaciation did not disturb their heights much, just rounded the suspected peaky tops into the bulbous forms we know today. And if you climb any of these mountains or see pictures of them, they are round and in many cases bare. Some of that is man-made, but some of it the glacier did. Glaciation did, however, leave dirt and boulders here and there, including the strange huge boulders perched by themselves throughout the park and called erratics. And they're very odd looking. Suddenly you're on a trail and this huge boulder is sitting right there beside it with nothing else around it. It's very odd looking. Glaciation also left many of the lakes and ponds. Some of these bodies of water dried up over the centuries, but left their traces. Today, farmers in the region sometimes find under their topsoil a large helping of pure white sand spread over their fields like sugar, marking the place where a lake once sparkled in the sun. Because the mountains, the rocky terrain, the various lakes and rivers, and the very long and harsh winter conditions made this area difficult for humans to use for sustenance or even to traverse, very few humans ventured into it until the 1800s. Native peoples in this part of the continent found little reason to tap the resources in these deep woods, since hunting and farming were more easily carried out in the valley areas southwest and northeast of the great forests and mountains which covered the area. At the time of Cartier and Champlain, the native peoples there who were the allies of the French were the Algonquins, of whom the Hurons were a part. It was the Hurons who accompanied Champlain on his trip of discovery in 1609. But the Hurons didn't live in this area. They only hunted around the edges of the eastern door of what is now the Adirondack State Park. It was the Mohawks, the keepers of the eastern door of the Iroquois Confederacy, who really claimed the Adirondack area, even though they too didn't live in the mountains. The Mohawks were fierce warriors and were determined to keep the Hurons and the French from their hunting grounds, so they allied themselves with the English. Thus, the French and Indian Wars came to New York State, and the battle for North America skittered through it in the mid-1700s. Many forts were built along Lake Champlain and Lake George, including what we know now as Ticonderoga and Crown Point, both of which were originally built by the French. Fort William Henry in what is now Lake George was built by the English. It was here at Fort William Henry that a horrible battle was waged in 1757. The English were defeated, and although Montcalm, the French commander, allowed the English survivors to leave the fort and walk to Fort Edward, another English fort a few miles away, the Hurons, once out of sight of their French commanders, massacred all the English. Montcalm did not know that they had done that and was mortified when he heard. The French victory was short-lived, however, as the Hurons and French were quickly chased back to Canada, and their eventual and final defeat on the Plains of Abraham in 1759. And that ended French rule in North America, was that one 20-minute battle outside what city in Canada? Quebec City, absolutely, yeah, Quebec City. The Plains of Abraham have no biblical connotation, by the way. There was a farmer named Abraham who owned the land. That's how it got its name. If you visit Quebec City, you can walk on it, and you can see the two stones where Montcalm fell and where General Wolfe, the English commander, fell, and both of them died on that day, within like 10 feet of each other. And it was a very quick battle. The French had no idea the English were coming, and they were not prepared, which always gives you a lesson there. Protect where you think the enemy is not going to come from, because that's what happened. Throughout the 1600s and 1700s, both the French and English sent their native allies into the Adirondack Forest to trap, especially for beaver, to make beaver hats, which was all the fashion then, and to cut the massive white pine trees which covered the mountainsides for use as ship masts. If you see a white pine, they grow straight as a die, and they're very strong, and that's what they needed to make the ship masts then. It is thought that the masts, spars, and planking used on the French and English battleships which engaged in the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805 came from white pines logged in the Adirondack forests. So they were exported to the militaries. And who was the English commander in 1805? Who won that battle? Yes, Lord Nelson, yes. So even he was under a mast from the Adirondack forest. When the American Revolution ended, native claims on the area were dissolved, as the Mohawks, like the rest of the Iroquois Confederacy, had been allies of the defeated English. The vast interior of the Adirondack area, then called the Great Northern Forest, remained uninhabited and inaccessible to most. But what a difference a few years can make. Years in which our young nation needed wood for building and tanning, and iron ore for cannons, and eventually for shipbuilding. Years in which wealthy city folk needed mountain vistas and cool lakes in which to rest from the hurly-burly of their busy lives downstate, and people with the dreaded lung disease, tuberculosis, needed the cold, resin-laden Adirondack air in which to recover. However, since the early 1800s were years of discovery in the western part of our country, the northern area of New York was neglected by most explorers. It wasn't until the century wore on a little that logging and mining concerns ramped up their operations in the Adirondacks. The area wasn't even given its present name of Adirondacks until 1837. It was in that year that Professor Ebenezer Emmons, who was working on the first geological survey of the region, named the mountain range containing the high peaks Adirondacks, after what he thought was the name of a former group of native people who had hunted there. This was not true, however, as the word Adirondacks was an Iroquois word used to describe the Algonquins, who, as I mentioned before, occasionally sojourned in this area and skirmished with the Mohawks in pre-colonial and colonial days. The word Adirondack really means people of the rocks. It wasn't long before the name Professor Emmons had conferred on the mountains came to refer to the entire region. Logging became a major business in the Adirondacks in the 19th century, and by 1850, the center of the massive forest had been penetrated by the lumbermen. They had been working inward from the outer rim of the pine-encrusted area for years. Glens Falls was the site of a huge lumber mill, and the owners of the logging companies invented a way of floating the severed white pines down the Hudson River to the mill. So we think that started out west somewhere with Paul Bunyan, but it didn't. It started in New York State. And sometimes the Hudson would have logs from shore to shore. And they had loggers who would hop from one log to another. It was very dangerous work getting those logs down to Glen Falls. At the time, New York was producing more lumber than any other state. And at the peak of the logging, 500,000 trees were cut in 1 year. And this was before they had chainsaws. This was by hand. The lumber companies bought up thousands of acres, stripping them of their trees, then let the ruined land go back for taxes to New York State. And the state did not appreciate it at the time. Gradually, the state came to own more and more of this unwanted property in the Adirondacks. Besides logging, mining interests found iron ore in the mountains and began pulling it out. This was difficult as railroads to bring the ore out were not plentiful in the rough terrain, but it was done. In fact, the iron used in the making of the USS Monitor of Civil War fame came from mines in the Adirondack Mountains. Wild animals were largely gone by the 1840s. Animals like the beaver and the moose. In fact, all the beaver were taken out of the Adirondack Forest by the 1840s. If you've been there, you see a lot of beaver there today. But the ancestors of the ones who are there today were brought in 1902 from British Columbia. The moose are only now coming back. So there are no real native animals in that part. There are descendants of immigrants, immigrant animals who came there, and we're grateful to them. By the 1870s, the Adirondacks was on the verge of being depleted of all its resources. Then several things began happening virtually at the same time. So that by 1895, many New Yorkers fought for the salvation of the area, and they won. This mass of what became a gorgeous hunk of real estate was afforded the most protected status of any land in the history of the nation. And that's still true today. In fact, some say it's the most protected real estate in the world. Starting in the 1870s, there were a handful of major events which spurred the preservation of the region for the public good. One such event was that Dr. Edward Trudeau opened his sanatorium for tuberculosis patients in Saranac Lake. Although it seems strange to say that tuberculosis patients could help advance forest preservation, it must be noted that at the time, that dreadful disease afflicted mostly the very poor and the very wealthy in our society. The illness struck the poor first because of the horrible conditions in our nation's slums in the 1800s. And many of the poor were domestics in the homes of the wealthy, thus spreading the tuberculosis bacillus to them. As the wealthy became ill and trekked to the Adirondacks, hopeful for a cure, many of them fell in love with the beauty of the area. And if they were successfully cured, either returned often for vacations or decided to stay there. Either way, these influential people held the Adirondacks in great esteem and could be counted on to help with conservation efforts. Many of them were very powerful people. The story of the courageous Dr. Trudeau and his place in the history of the Adirondacks is definitely a fascinating one. Dr. Trudeau was a doctor in New York City, and he himself contracted tuberculosis. He was married and had two children, a son and a daughter, and he was experimenting with the best ways to find a cure. And he found that when he went to the Adirondacks, that his symptoms improved dramatically. And he started inviting people up. He went back to New York City and realized his symptoms were getting worse. So he he could deduce from that that there was something in the Adirondacks that was helping. So he opened a sanatorium there, private, but he was a very giving man. He would take in people who couldn't afford to come, as well as the wealthy. The wealthy paid so much that he could afford to do that, although he was never a wealthy man himself. Finally, his daughter contracted the disease and passed away. And by that time, New York State had become interested because so many people had tuberculosis. And it was in the public interest for the state and the national government, actually, to find a cure for this horrible disease. Healthy young people were dying of this dreadful disease, and no one knew how to cure it. So finally, Dr. Trudeau passed away himself. His sanatorium kept going, and New York State also had a hospital there. The people in Saranac Lake were opening their homes to patients. They had what they call cure cottages, even though I understand it's very difficult, if not impossible, to actually cure tuberculosis. Nonetheless, they had open porches on the sides, and part of this cure was to put the patients outside in the cold, even during the winter. They'd wrap them up in big blankets and give them very fat-laden food, whole milk and cream and butter and meat. And so the farmers in the area were having, you know, they were having a great time. They were making out very well there, and so were these people who were renting their cottages. But finally, after World War II and the advent of antibiotics, there was a cure for tuberculosis, and Dr. Trudeau's clinic closed as a tuberculosis center in 1954. And his last patient walked through the door. He was a former Major League Baseball player, Larry Doyle from, I think, the New York Giants. And he was the last patient to leave. Dr. Trudeau's son and grandson both became physicians also, and they carried on their forebears' work. But his great-grandson picked an entirely new occupation. Does anyone know who Dr. Trudeau's great-grandson was?
Is?
Gary Trudeau. Yes, you may have read him in the funny paper this morning. He writes Doonesbury cartoons, and he is the great-grandson of the Dr. Edward Trudeau who helped so many people. So public service runs in the family. Another event that contributed to the creation of the Adirondack State Park was the influx of tourists into the area. This chapter in the Adirondack's history started with the appearance of a few wealthy Americans who went there seeking harmony with nature. Their idea of harmony, however, was the building of the many great camps or rustic appearing mansions which sprang up starting around 1880. The first of these great camps was designed by a man named William West Durant, a self-styled architect from New York City whose father had opened the first, albeit short, railroad into the Adirondacks. The appearance of the great camp domiciles came from the design of the Swiss Chalet, which Durant had seen on his trips to Europe. Great camps also embraced the different idea of having buildings for living and sleeping separate from those for dining, for kitchen work, and for entertainment. You can visit these camps. They are still, most of them are not owned by the wealthy people who built them anymore, but certainly you can visit Sagamore Great Camp, and you can see the various buildings they had for various duties, chores, entertaining, whatever. They even have a covered bowling alley outside their camp, so that was the Vanderbilt, so they could afford it. The Sagamore Great Camp at Sagamore Lake, once owned by the Vanderbilts, is probably Durant's most famous design. It's located near Racket Lake in the south central part of the park and is open for public tours and as a conference site still today. I know people who've taken their grandchildren there for grandparent-grandchild conferences. Also, writers and musicians found this area inspiring. In the summer of 1858, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Louis Agassiz, and other writers spent time camping near Follansbee Pond, west of the Saranacs. Their guides quickly called the place the Philosopher's Camp. William Chapman White, tongue firmly tucked in cheek, writes, Longfellow had been invited, but refused when he heard that the lofty Emerson was going to take a gun. No gun was ever fired, and nothing else happened, except that Emerson wrote a 10-page poem on the experience. Not much of a camping trip, and not much of a poem. But it wasn't just the wealthy and famous who found the Adirondack area a wonderful place to visit. The American middle class began coming to the region in the 1880s, and hotels and clubs for their use were busily being constructed. Their voices to preserve this area were another source of pressure on state government to clamp down on those whose greed allowed them to treat the area with negligence. And you can see some of these places still, the hotels in Lake Placid, that was a popular spot for people to go, and Melville Dewey had a club there, the Lake Placid Club, which was quite controversial. The library fellow who invented the Dewey Decimal System, he started a club for middle class people up there and ran into a little problem with it, but it still became quite the spot. People still go there. If you go through Lake Placid today, cars are still bumper to bumper in this little tiny town. Beautiful spot. Probably the most important reason the Adirondack State Park was formed was because the downstate legislators were afraid the loggers would destroy the water sources for New York City. The city's population was growing by leaps and bounds, and there was great fear that if the logging and mining continued unabated, the Hudson would dry up. That was the scientific theory then, that if you cut down all the trees, the erosion would destroy the river. New York City had no other place to go to get their water, and New York was growing just by huge amounts. It was largely because of this anxiety that the park was created and that the state constitution contained the 1895 Forever Wild Amendment. As a side note, when the park boundaries were drawn in 1892, the park planners used a blue pencil to outline its borders on their map. Therefore, inside the blue line and outside the blue line became common Adirondack phrases to designate whether one was inside or outside of the park limits. And people still talk about that today. We must remember here too that, as so often happens in these save and protect movements, often the voice of one dedicated, passionate spirit stands out among all the others. That strong voice in the campaign to protect the Adirondacks was that of the first official surveyor of the region, who was appointed by the state legislature in 1871. His name was Verplank Colvin. Mount Colvin is named after him. In his many years as surveyor, Colvin tramped practically every square foot of the park, sometimes being the first person to traverse some of the areas. Independently wealthy and eager for the task, and a little unusual, this fellow was. He used his own money to buy all his equipment because he was so in love with the Adirondack region. He totally immersed himself in his work. He spent years plotting his surveys and writing multiple reports about his trips, reports which still read today like fine literature. His scientific reports are just beautifully done. It was his persistence that won the area its first vote of protection in 1885 as a forest preserve, and some of the language in his reports found its way into the eventual legislation creating the park in 1895. In that year, Article 7 of Section 7 of the State Constitution, it's now Article 14 of the same document, went into effect. This is the famous Forever Wild Amendment. It's only two sentences, and this is what it says. The lands of the state now owned or hereafter acquired, constituting the forest preserve as now fixed by law, shall be forever kept as wild forest lands. They shall not be leased, sold, or exchanged, or be taken by any corporation, public or private, nor shall the timber thereon be sold, removed, or destroyed. That's it. And it's the same today as it was in 1895. It's one of the reasons so many of us are tremulous about a constitutional convention, because that would be on the table. And there are developers just champing at the bit to get in there. What must be said about the Forever Wild Constitutional Amendment, first of all, is its total uniqueness. No other state or national park, forest, monument, etc., is granted the protection that the Adirondack State Park has. From January 1st, 1895 to the present moment, this protection has been sacrosanct. It's also important to remember that it wasn't the mountains that the state wanted to preserve back then. Even though they're beautiful and certainly what most people think of when they think of the park, it was really the trees that would keep the water supply intact, and they were the catalyst for the Forever Wild Amendment. The park now encompasses 6 million acres, less than half owned by the people of New York State. This includes the land the state had taken from the lumber companies for back taxes that they hadn't wanted, but they're glad they have now, and also hundreds of thousands of acres, including the high peaks that the state has purchased over the decades. Hard to think that a private entity once owned the high peaks in the Adirondacks, but they did. New York State had to buy them. Just over 50% of the park is privately owned by towns, homeowners, and some industries, the largest private owner being International Paper Company. Because what happens on the private portions of the park impacts the public portions, in 1971, the Adirondack Park Agency was created by the legislature to oversee zoning restrictions throughout the park. And these restrictions apply whether the land is privately or publicly owned. This was a highly controversial move and remains so today. Sometimes the commissioners need the wisdom of Solomon to deal with angry landowners in the park. And many times the commissioners don't last too long on that commission because they get so browbeaten, but they have to be strong and they have to do what is best for the park as a whole. What also must be honored in the park is the necessity of coming to the people of the state if changes are to be made therein. The Adirondack Park Association can regulate zoning, but they cannot change an iota of what was created in 1895 unless that change is voted on in a plebiscite by the citizens of New York State. This is the strength a constitutional amendment holds. It's also why we need to check the state propositions offered practically every November in our elections to see if any of them pertain to the Adirondack State Park. Two of them did last year. The Adirondack State Park has a website, and I have a bibliography up here for you, which you may take, and it lists the important websites dealing with the park. And the Adirondack Mountain Club is listed there. Also, the League of Women Voters has a nice flyer every year where they list the pros and cons of various propositions. Most people don't pay any attention to the propositions, but they're very important when it comes to the park. In the public areas of the park, they can't remove a tree, they can't do anything, unless the people of New York say it's all right. In the privately owned land, yes, they do take trees out. Obviously, International Paper Company wouldn't be there unless they could do that. But they have become wise over the years and learned to replant after they take their trees out. So we who live and pay our taxes in our great state can be extraordinarily proud of our Adirondacks. It's a place like few others in the world, a place that stands apart as a mighty inspiration of nature, a place where we can be enveloped in nature's essence and made to feel a part of the interdependent web of life. William White said it so well when he wrote the following about the Adirondack region. As a man tramps the woods to the lake, he knows he will find pines and lilies, blue herons and golden shiners, shadows on the rocks and the glint of light on the wavelets, just as they were in the summer of 1354, as they will be in 2054 and beyond. He can stand on a rock by the shore and be in a past he could not have known, in a future he will never see. He can be a part of time that was and time yet to come. Thank you. There are some books up here that I brought. I also have a map which shows you in the dark green outline there the extent of the park. It does have, I mean, Lake George is included in it, part of Lake Champlain, etc. So it's quite a vast area that has is part of the park. And there are some books up here. Those of you who are familiar with the Adirondacks may have read many of these already. But if you have not, Anne LaBastille was one of the wonderful writers of the park. She built a cabin for herself, a couple of them actually, and has had several books out before her passing at a very young age. But her memoirs are stunning and just beautifully written. Nehassani, Fire Observer, this is a charming book by an elderly lady who was a fire warden or observer during the 1940s, during World War II. She was a young girl, like 17. And every summer, they would hire people to go up in the fire towers. There were phones up there, and they would phone if they saw a fire off in the distance because it was very dangerous in the Adirondacks. Well, she would have to phone the next tower every so often to tell them all was well. And she had to climb the mountain every morning and climb back down. She had a place to stay, but she'd be up there in the tower by herself all day. And the first day she was up, they'd always had men doing this, but the young men were off in the service, so they were hiring these young girls. And she phoned the tower next to her to report, and the man was gasping, you're a girl. And she said, well, yes, and I also have two eyes, and I can look out here and see whether there is a fire. So, but it's a very lovely story of her first summer there. Bill McKibben is a nature writer. Some of you may have read his book called The End of Nature that came out several years ago. But he lives in the Adirondacks with his family, and this is about a hike he took through the Adirondacks and into Vermont. and the people he met along the way. Very, very nice. And small, you could read it in an afternoon. Robert Taylor's book, Saranac, I found in a Lake Placid bookstore and thought it sounded good and brought it home, and I'm so glad I did. It's a delightful story about the various people who came to stay in Saranac. Some of them were tuberculosis patients, some were not. He talks a little bit about Dr. Trudeau here, but it really is a very nice read. Robert Taylor was a journalist by trade, so his writing is superb. And The Woman in the Mountain is writings by women who lived in the Adirondacks. Poets, novelists, short story writers, prose, journalistic writing. Some of them, again, came as tuberculosis patients and stayed, and some of them just came back and forth for their vacations. But it's only the women who are included in here. This is something that SUNY published many years ago. Most of these are available in the public library, and I think Mr. Amazon has some of them as well, if you wanted to own some of them. And the primary book is Adirondack Country by William Chapman White. This is an astounding story, really. If you want to know about the background of the park, this is the one to go to. Beautifully written and a very nice story. There are a couple of other books up here, one on the great camps and one pictures that were taken by a professional photographer a few years ago. One other thing I wanted to mention too, I mentioned the size of the Adirondack Park and that it was the largest one in the country. And I also remembered after I said that it is actually larger than Grand Canyon, Zion, and Yosemite put together. So it is a huge, huge park. And obviously the largest one the country would have to be. And a very unusual way with the public and private lands together. It's tough to have that going on in the same area, but it's worked so far. Yes?
So out of the ski resorts and the racetracks, inside or outside the blue line?
Well, if they're inside the park, they are probably privately owned, but they are inside the park. Oh, that's Canadian. Yeah, this is only New York State. Mont Tremblant is in Quebec. So this is it, yeah. That's a pretty area, though. We've been up there, too.
I have two questions. First, is your talk going to be available to us? Do you have it in print? I saw you were reading.
It hasn't been published, no.
Okay, would you be willing?
It's on the
I am filming think they it, recorded hopefully put it, it on here, the so. Website.
Regarding the name, we hikers and campers have a common wisdom that the name was an Algonquin pejorative term meaning eaters of bark.
I've heard that too, but it's I think it was White who said that it's people of the rocks.
Okay.
That's
it's
better.
One of those apocryphal things that you can take one way or the other,
yeah,
but I
think
that's
probably
yeah.
Migrated to the southern part of the state, the civilized part of Baldwinsville and Syracuse.
Yes, that I can understand that would happen in that area. That very, very few ways of getting in and out, and it was the terrain was really, really rough. But that would be dangerous too to be riding on the log. So she was a brave girl.
No Pullman cars.
Yeah. Yes.
From the Midwestern factories is adversely affecting
Yes, the acid rain. Yep, we were just talking about that this morning, and that Anne LaBastille died of Alzheimer's. And they are thinking because someone was, who was it? Yes. That because she collected rainwater to drink at her cabin, that could have hastened her Alzheimer's at a young age because it had acid rain in it. But yes,
mercury.
That is it.
Mercury.
Yeah.
Mercury.
It was ruining the white pines as well. So what happens next door or the next state, you know, impacts what happens here as well with so many things. So there are some things that states' rights just don't work for. Yes.
I had a college classmate named Roger Marshall who had, I think, an uncle or something like that named Bob, who was supposedly well-known, at least he claimed, as an advocate of certain areas of the park. Do you know anything about Bob Marshall?
No, I don't.
There's a Mount Marshall, right? One of the 46, no?
I think there's a wilderness area named for him.
Okay.
I went to college forestry, and the outdoor club was called the Bob Marshall Club. And
okay.
I think he was an alumni of the state forestry school.
The area, he would claim, was called the Bob. Mm-hmm. But he was there protecting.
The Bob.
I didn't know whether he was fooling me or not.
You know, that the ADK could probably answer that for you very quickly.
Bob Marshall was the part of the group that first completed the 46 high peaks. He was one of the first 46ers. And his father, Louis Marshall, was one of the writers of the Forever Wild 1895 Clause. And they have a summer cottage on a lower Saranac Lake.
So he wasn't jerking you around in SLA.
It was real. Wonderful.
Thank
you. Thank you.
Theodore Roosevelt was involved with this in a big way.
Oh, yes, he was. He loved the Adirondacks. He and his family went there frequently. In fact, I just gave a talk on Theodore Roosevelt, the TR site. He was our greenest president, and from the time he was a little kid, he loved the outdoors and loved wild animals, and he was visited the Adirondacks many, many.
He was on a hunting trip, or
well, yes, they did twice. As a matter of fact, he was in the Adirondacks giving a speech at the time that McKinley was shot, and he rushed back to Buffalo, and then McKinley was improving, and he went back to continue the family vacation, and they had just summited Mount Marcy, and they were coming down, they were at Lake Tier of the Clouds in the afternoon, and a runner came up and said that McKinley was dying and you must return immediately. And everybody tried to say, you're not going to get down the mountain to the train today. You've got to spend the night here. No, I have to go down now. And there's a wonderful write-up of it in, I don't have time to read it. It's very short in the Adirondack Reader. It's like a page and a half.
You've got until 10:15.
Oh, okay. It's a great story. On Friday, September 13th, Roosevelt and some friends made an ascent of Mount Marcy. On the afternoon of the day before, these gentlemen and the ladies in their party left the main clubhouse at the Upper Works and went to a rough camp on Lake Colden. Here they spent the night. The following morning, the ladies returned to the clubhouse and the men proceeded to climb Marcy. They left Lake Colden at 9 a.m. and by noon had reached the summit of the mountain. They remained there about 15 minutes and then descended a few hundred feet to the shelf of land that holds Lake Tier of the Clouds, where they rested. While chatting and looking around, they saw a hurrying guide emerge from the woods below. A few moments later, this man handed Mr. Roosevelt a telegram, which told him that President McKinley's condition had suddenly changed for the worse. This was at 1:30. The party immediately hurried down the mountain and reached the clubhouse at 5:30.
Oh,
Finding no further news there, Mr. Roosevelt reluctantly consented to spend the night, but made arrangements to leave at the earliest possible moment in the morning. At 11 o'clock that night, Mr. McNaughton brought him another message saying that the president was dying. Without a moment's hesitation, Mr. Roosevelt declared his intention of starting immediately for Buffalo and asked for a conveyance. At this, his friends, seconded by the guides, urged him to wait till daylight. The roads were so rough and treacherous as to be considered impassable of a dark night, and this night was of the darkest. The men around the club were not the kind to balk at any ordinary risk, but none of them cared to be the driver in this one. Being informed of this, Mr. Roosevelt said he would take a lantern and go afoot. This threat, backed by preparatory action, induced one of the guides, Dave Hunter, to volunteer as a driver. A little later, the start was made in a now historic night ride from one of the most isolated spots in the wilderness to the nearest railway station at North Creek, 40 miles away. The trip was planned in relays, for Mr. Roosevelt not only insisted on going, he insisted on going fast. The result was an utterly reckless dash through the darkness, a race with death in more senses than one. That the nation did not lose two presidents that night was little short of miraculous. But as we now know, fate was reserving this devotee of danger for the most peaceful of endings. The first relay of the journey was driven by Dave Hunter, the second by Orrin Kellogg, the third and last by Mike Cronin, who was waiting at Aden Lair with a team of gaunt black horses, restless for the final dash. At 3 a.m., Mr. Roosevelt arrived, jumped from one buckboard to the other, and plunged wildly into the night again. At 4:39 a.m., he alighted at the North Creek station, where a special train was waiting, and he was met by Secretary Loeb, who gave him the news that he was President of the United States.
Wow.
As driver of the last lap in this famous ride, Mike Cronin became a sort of national hero. He was written to and interviewed about until he gradually evolved a recital of the adventure that connected some thrilling detail with every bump and turn in the road. He also gave away more souvenir horseshoes than his team of blacks could have worn in a lifetime. According to William Chapman White, about 400 homes in the Adirondacks used to cherish an authentic shoe from Cronin's team of black horses. So go to the Adirondacks, have a great time, and even if you don't climb mountains, it's still a beautiful spot to go.
We still have time for questions if anybody wants
yes.
to.
What are some of your favorite places?
Tupper Lake area. My sister-in-law used to live in Plattsburgh, and we would go and visit her and then come in. The ponds in some of the areas. Lake Placid is always a favorite. The museum at Blue Mountain is wonderful, just wonderful. I could have spent days there. And they have upgraded it since the last time we were there, so we want to go back and see that.
There's one dimension, as you mentioned, Blue Mountain Lake. One dimension we haven't mentioned was about the boats in the Adirondacks. And the Adirondack guideboat
yeah.
was developed for this, which I do boat building, so I'm into this. But that was a phenomenon. It's almost a cult now about the Adirondack guideboat. It's like a canoe, but you row it. It's very sophisticated. They tried to make it light because they had to portage and so forth and so on. And it's somewhat mythically, people talk about, oh, you could put a whole moose in there, you know, and go around, you know, and they're so wonderful. We've actually built a couple of those, but there's quite a large club of aficionados of that. And also canoeing, and that was one of the places that in the 1880s and 1890s, as the canoe was being mass produced by Old Town and Morris and others and so forth, that was one of the main places where canoeing really, really developed.
Yes, it is. And the guides, there are still, I think they're licensed, actually, guides in the Adirondacks who will take you around. And our Botanical Society went up one time and hired a guide, and she took us out and showed us various things in the area around Speculator. But yeah, that is. And the boats are at the Blue Mountain Museum. You can see some of the older boats, but they're very unusual looking. And some of these guides, you know, these grizzled old guys that would live in the backwoods and come out in the summer and take tourists around, but they knew every little plant, everything, every animal of the area that they would take people out in. So yeah, it was quite something.
How do you compare the Adirondacks with Algonquin Park in Canada?
I've never been to Algonquin. Our daughter has been there and she loves it back in there. I think it's wilder, Algonquin. There are towns around the edge, but I don't think there's anything within it. And it's, other than that, you know, that you can go boating, certainly, in Algonquin, take the boat. She has taken a boat way into the backcountry and camped. And
it's famous for a boys' camp there that's very well known, and they're famous for their taking portages throughout the whole park.
Oh, wow.
I know a family that lived there year-round in the 1930s. In fact, we'll see her in a couple of weeks. Actually lived in that park through the winter. Mm-hmm. And I went there one time, and in the middle of the night I had to get up and walk to the outhouse, and on the way I heard a sound. And they said, oh, it was a bear.
Adirondack or Algonquin?
Algonquin.
Algonquin, okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Following up on John's guidebook, there's also a class of sailboat that's unique to the Adirondacks, the IDEM, I-D-E-M.
Okay. Yes.
Do you have any recommended guided tour of the Adirondacks?
No, I don't. It's something that, again, you could probably check with the club, the ADK, about, and just see the kind of things. Yes. The president,
ask
former
Janet,
president
she'll
over
know.
Here.
So about the political situation there, are the counties and townships in New York State actually are overlapped by this, right?
Yeah.
So you look at a county that runs some of it's outside the line, some of it's inside the line. How does that work for county governments or for voting? And so, I mean, just that the state owns a big section of your county, is that correct?
Yeah, and most people live in the towns. I mean, they would live on private land. Unless you were hired by the state, you wouldn't be living in the public land. So the county would have jurisdiction over that, but the state has jurisdiction over the public lands that are in the park.
Well, and also the Adirondack Park Agency oversees the zoning, which you referred to. So some of the land use issues subservient to the park agency because it's a higher level of government.
We had a speaker here before the constitutional issue had come up, and one of his suggestions was that there are a lot of quirky little problems that the towns have, like they can't repair a road, or they can't take a telephone pole down or something. I mean and that was part of the argument for, well, we need to kind of clean this whole thing up. But I understand the fear of opening this up now to political, all the political forces, especially as they are now.
And I think one of those issues was taken care of in the last election, because that was one of the issues that was on the ballot, was something with towns having jurisdiction over some kind of thing that they were doing, and people did pass that, so that now becomes law. So
yeah,
that the towns
for land swaps, so that if you needed to straighten a road, and it would take forest preserve property, that there would be a bank of land.
Right. Yeah. You had something, my dear.
I just would mention. I
mentioned to my uncle years ago that traffic was bad in Lake Placid. He told me he was there with friends in 1919. His friend had a Buick at the time, older car, and traffic was just as bad then as it is now.
Another thing is that John Brown's, the abolitionist, his home is just outside Lake Placid, and you can go up and see that, and he's buried there. He and I think there were two sons that were with him at Harper's Ferry, who one was killed, and wasn't another one hanged with him? But they're buried there as well, and he had 11 children, I think, 11 or 12, that he was raising in this little house. And his long-suffering wife living up here in the coal country, I think because he felt he was safer up there than living closer to a town. But that property is still available for public to go and visit.
Last question.
This is kind of upbeat note. Is there a story around the Adirondack chair?
Not that I know. I know that the Adirondack chairs are unique, and I don't know what the story is around that. They can be a little uncomfortable too, especially when you're trying to get out.
They're from the great camps.
From the great camps, okay. That's a good question, though. I think I might look that up and find out what the design of that is and where that comes from.
And the Adirondack lean-to is also unique.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a lot of, at the end of the 19th century, that the Adirondacks sort of led the way in this kind of rustic style of architecture as part of this whole romanticism and Hudson River School and all that kind of business. And one of the things that's really quite charming about this is where they would use pieces of wood right off the tree, you know, to make the railings, and so it would leave the bark on it and so forth, so that even though you could have a very, like these lodges are extremely sophisticated and well served and so forth, but they look good. You know, they look like they fit in.
Yeah.
And Frank Lloyd Wright and a lot of other architects that kind of emerged in the late 19th century, early 20th century, kind of picked up on that idea of getting the buildings to blend in with their environment.
Yes.
That was kind of a new idea that you go to the Adirondacks, you see a bright white house, you know, somewhere.
Yeah, and these camps, how you're right, they're
dark part. Green, dark brown, you know, dark brown with dark red trim on the windows. That was all kind of a way to kind of camouflage the intrusion into the wilderness.
Exactly, yes. And in fact, there's a chapter in Saranac where he's writing about Marjorie Meriwether Post, and she had this fancy house in the wilderness, and he visited it. And of course, the Hudson River starts at, anybody know?
Lake Tear of the Clouds.
Tear of the Clouds, yep. Lake Tear of the Clouds. And it was Verplank Colvin that figured that out. He was the first one to see the source of the Hudson.
We're going to have to stop now, 20 after. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.